Good evening and welcome to 10 News. First, WA households will be $160 a year worse off with water, power and other charges increasing under today's state budget. Political reporter Michael Bennett has the details live from Parliament House. And Michael, amid the cost of living hikes, Treasurer Christian Porter is also looking heavily to the future.
That's right, Narelle. Good evening. While there have been increases in water and electricity, they are modest rises and have been countered by some subsidies for low-income earners. What's important to remember from today is that it's the Barnett government's pre-election budget, with the poll less than 10 months away. And that's likely been the reason that the Treasurer has kept household charges at a minimum. The standout feature of today's budget was the Barnett government locking away money in its future fund.
The $1 billion centrepiece of today's budget, the future fund, will come from royalty for regions money, reaching at least $4.7 billion by 2032. Every year from then, an estimated $230 million will be available for governments to spend. Planning for the future a must, according to the Treasurer, with the population and economy growth at historically high rates.
With this growth, the demand for government services and infrastructure is growing faster year on year.
But Christian Porter's budget sweeteners weren't aimed just at future voters. West Australians struggling with the rising cost of living will be eligible for help with power bills, up to 35% under a government subsidy scheme. There are also bumps in seniors' cost of living rebates, and the concessions will be needed. Electricity will rise again by a less than expected 3.5%, but the federal government's carbon tax means the total rise will be about 11%. Water will go up by 6%. For an average household, it will mean an extra $160 a year. Small business gets a boost with a payroll tax rebate, saving 7,000 small businesses up to $41,000 each. $6.7 billion goes to health, with extra cash for community health services, including 100 new child health nurses and an upgrade of Royal Perth Hospital. Education gets $4 billion. A large slice will be spent relocating Year 7 students to high school. More than $80 million goes to implementing Mick Kilty's bushfire recommendations. $1.4 billion will be spent on energy infrastructure, including upgrades to the wooden pole network.
The government's massive asset investment program in health, in education, in electricity and water infrastructure and for Perth City will represent an enduring physical gift to future West Australians.
Today's small $196 million surplus is countered by state debt that's predicted to blow out to $18.5 billion. The Treasurer admitting the surplus isn't huge, but it's safe.
Well, the opposition says there are no surprises in this budget.
That's right. Opposition Leader Mark McGowan says this is a safe budget, but the Barnett government has still managed to reach new levels of state debt. Meanwhile, I spoke with Treasurer Christian Porter a short time ago, who's defended his decision to go ahead with a future fund investment.
Most people have suggested to me it would have been an easier vote winner just to spend the money right here and now leading up to an election, but that would have been irresponsible and not in the best and longest interests of the state. So, depending on your view, it's either a vote winner or a vote loser, but we're doing it because it's right. And it's right to provide for the present generation's children because we are digging out the minerals and selling them today. And they're owned not just by us, but they're owned by next generation and a generation after that.
What we now see is an incredibly strong focus by the government on inner city projects at the expense of suburban West Australia and the towns around our great state. On top of that, the debt increase is nothing short of astounding. We now have debt going to $18 billion and in the year after this budget, $24 billion. That's up from $3.6 billion when the Barnett government came to office.
And Michael, how have industry leaders and interest groups reacted to the budget?
It's been a mixed reaction from various groups. The AMA in particular have been heavily critical of the Barnett government, saying the health budget isn't keeping up with demand. Meanwhile, on the effectiveness of the future fund, business and mining are split.
With 1,000 people a week flocking to work in the West, the government's accused of shortchanging the health system by hundreds of millions.
We've got a tidal wave of demand coming through. And currently the public hospitals are looking at a 2% increase next year. We're facing 8 to 10% increase in demand. This is a woeful budget.
And though cost of living increases have been kept to inflation, there are big concerns for the working poor. Brodie Clayton and Rosemary Moore each earn just over $40,000 a year and don't qualify for increased hardship rebates.
I'm still paying off my last electricity bill when I'm getting the new one in. It's just not going to cut it for me.
I'm really worried about my family. I'm worried about my other co-workers, how they're going to be able to afford to meet these costs.
Again, it doesn't offset all of the impacts of the charges that we've seen over the recent years. So we do think that there is still a need for further concessions reform.
Social service groups welcome the $29 million child health boost, but woes continue for public housing. Homes West waiting times forecast to jump from 113 to 134 weeks this year. Worries too, the budget's $244 million efficiency drive will further squeeze government services.
Look, it's certainly not a budget for families, quite the opposite.
A mixed reception for the Future Fund. Business says the $300 million stashed away so far would be better spent today.
Business are the generators of wealth, and investing today will drive wealth for future generations far in excess of a savings vehicle that the government establishes.
A very significant aspect of this budget. That is something that we welcome.
I think it's very important to be investing from the finite resources of the current West Australian economy.
And while the payroll tax rebate's welcome, struggling small traders are demanding more help.
But we could see improvements there and make it an ongoing commitment because it is affordable in this year's budget.
Meanwhile, business calls to cut overall stamp duty and payroll tax rates have gone unheeded. They'll have to wait until WA's GST fight with Canberra has been resolved. Nick Way, 10 News.
Well, as we heard, low-income earners and pensioners will be eligible for extra help. What do they make of this budget?
Yeah, Craig, it seems they have been some of the big winners in today's carve-up, but for some of them, the money won't stretch far at all.
Single mother of four, Heather Morrissey, will see her bills go up by more than $3 a week.
It all adds up at the end of the day. I mean, it is extremely hard raising kids on your own. With the increase of prices, it makes it that little bit tougher.
The good news is the Morrissey family will receive the budget's new cost of living assistance payment of $200. That on top of a $434 payout from the dependent children's rebate gives Heather a total assistance payment package of $634 a year. That means Heather's yearly rebate will be around 40% of her annual electricity bill, but she says it won't make much of a dent at all to the ongoing rising costs of raising a family.
I am glad they are trying to compensate us with something, but as I said, down the track, it's really not going to help us at all.
Up the road in Westminster, pensioners John and Audrey Andrews are also set to be slugged with the 3.56% rise in utility prices.
Up to now, we managed to pay, but I'm dreading the next lots of bills coming in.
Despite an $80 increase to their senior cost of living rebate, plus the COLA payout of $200, the couple says they'll still struggle.
They don't know what it's like to live like we have to do on a pension.
By the time they finish, it'll be like nothing. We're worse off.
And the key feature in this year's budget, the Future Fund, also copping criticism.
In my opinion, they have their priorities all wrong.
Alicia Banner, 10 News.
So a big day for Christian Porter and his second state budget. Increases in electricity and water, while modest, will hit the bottom line for some. There's only 12 months away until less than 12 months until the next election. In that time, we'll see if today's budget has hit its target. From Parliament House, it's back to you.
We'll leave our budget coverage there. Michael Bennett, Parliament House, thanks for those reports.